you know, been working really hard with a larger committee of medical experts to develop an educational plan. And we're here to tell you about that, as well as SCDAA's overall response to the COVID-19 pandemic. I'm the Chief Medical Officer of the Sickle Cell Disease Association of America. I'm also a hematologist, and I direct the New England Sickle Cell Institute at the University of Connecticut. And Dr. Sue is my partner. He's the Vice Chief Medical Officer of the SCDAA, a professor of pediatrics at the University of Illinois at Chicago, and a sickle cell expert. Next slide, please. So what is COVID-19? I think most of you probably heard a lot about it at this point. So as an overview, it is a brand new virus that was first identified in China at the end of 2019. And since that time, we've all witnessed the global spread of the virus. And for most parts of the world, the number of cases has not quite peaked, unfortunately. There are a lot of implications about being a new virus, and quite simply, being something new means that we humans have never seen it before, and our immune systems have never encountered it before. So we don't have the natural protection that we have against other viruses and bacteria that we commonly come into contact with, because we've never seen it before. So when someone gets infected, they have the potential to react pretty strongly to try to fight it. What's really important, and an overall theme for today, is for you to remember that the knowledge that we have about COVID-19 and how it can and probably will affect those living with sickle cell disease is an evolving evolving area. And the information that we're giving you today is only as good as today. So it's really important that you continue to stay updated regarding the latest about COVID-19 and sickle cell disease in the coming days and weeks and months. So the risk to our community, our sickle cell community in the United States could change. And again, please stay informed, and please go regularly to the Sickle Cell Disease of America website to get updated information. Next slide, please. So sickle cell disease and COVID-19, is important to talk about these two diseases together? I think absolutely. So if you look to the left side of the slide, that is a map of the United States, and it's a graph representing the numbers of individuals with sickle cell disease that are believed to live in each one of the 50 United States. And the darker the color, the more persons are known to be affected by sickle cell disease. To the right, this is now a little bit old, a couple weeks old, but this is the map of the United States and where the documented cases of COVID-19 have been. And it's really, important to note that these graphs are almost superimposable. So where sickle cell patients live, in many ways are some of the areas of our country with the highest numbers of COVID-19 cases. So the likelihood of community spread of COVID-19 to individuals with sickle cell disease is very, very high. Next slide, please. So what do you need to know about COVID-19? So first of all, it's a real pandemic. If you're still getting any information out there that somehow this is fake news and it's not real and it's all made up, it's not. This is a real pandemic. And we are, every single one of us, at risk of getting infected. And we know that individuals with sickle cell disease, by virtue of their disease, have weaker immune systems on average than most other people. And we also know that the best way to keep from getting a serious infection or illness associated with 19 is to try not to get infected in the first place. Next slide, please. So us who talk about sickle cell disease and living with sickle cell disease often use the term crisis. And most times that word crisis is used to describe the acute painful events that people who live with sickle cell disease experience. But you know, now that we're living in the COVID-19 pandemic, we're really encountering a new type of crisis that can affect in quite consequential ways those individuals affected by sickle cell disease. Now, we know that individuals with sickle cell disease commonly suffer from not only chronic complications from having the disease over a long period of time, but also acute manifestations of the disease. And both of them require close contact with the medical system. And ongoing close contact with the medical system really conflicts entirely with the message that we're all getting to stay at home to try to keep ourselves from getting infected with COVID-19. And so living with a chronic disease like sickle cell disease in the setting of the COVID-19 pandemic, where the message is to stay at home, try not to get infected, minimize community spread, really poses both logistical challenges for how individuals with sickle cell disease are supposed to get ongoing high quality, good care for both acute issues and chronic disease management. But it also poses for the clinicians, for the healthcare provider, some diagnostic and treatment challenges in trying to meet the healthcare needs of those living with sickle cell disease during the pandemic. And you'll see on the right-hand side, it's not a complete list, but there's a partial list that I've made of some chronic complications that individuals with sickle cell disease can develop. And then on the bottom right, some acute complications. And these include pain, they include fever and infection, but at the bottom there in red and with three asterisks, you'll see the acute chest syndrome. And we're gonna talk a little bit more about that because it's very important in the setting of the COVID-19 crisis. Next slide, please. So what is the acute chest syndrome? It's a term that we clinicians use to describe a constellation of signs and symptoms in individuals with sickle cell disease. And these include someone saying they have chest pain, that they have a cough, they have a fever. And then when we evaluate them, oftentimes we find that their oxygen level is low, that's called hypoxia. And if we do a chest x-ray, oftentimes we see abnormalities on chest x-ray that we call infiltrates. And quite honestly, these signs and symptoms look a lot like COVID-19 infection. And if you look to the right side there, there are two chest x-rays, and the first one on the left is a chest x-ray from a publication on a patient with sickle cell disease who had the acute chest syndrome. And you'll see those shadows in the lungs, those white shadows, those are abnormalities. And then on the right side chest x-ray, that's a chest x-ray of a publication demonstrating the effects on the lung of COVID-19 infection. That's in someone without sickle cell disease. So, you know, to us as clinicians, these look very similar. And moreover, it's quite possible that COVID-19 infection in someone with sickle cell disease can occur at the same time as an acute chest syndrome. And it's hard to discern between the two. And it's important that clinicians recognize that individuals with sickle cell disease can have both of these at the same time. And it's possible that COVID-19 infection could even exacerbate or bring on the acute chest syndrome. And both of these conditions are a high risk state, not only for respiratory distress or difficulty with breathing, but also the need for intubation or what is commonly called being on a ventilator. And both conditions are put individuals at increased risk of death. So it's something we really need to pay attention to and have at the top of our minds. Next slide, please. So I hope that I've impressed upon you that cell disease is really a high risk medical condition for the development of severe COVID-19 infection. And In light of this, you know, we at the SCDAA feel very strongly that it's our duty and obligation, what here to do is to ensure that persons living with sickle cell disease and their caregivers and loved ones, as well as their healthcare providers, have the proper guidance to manage this pandemic. And that includes enhanced preparedness, being given tools on how best to be prepared, what safety and prevention measures can be taken to try to minimize contracting COVID-19, ways to modify how people use healthcare, and we'll talk about that on subsequent slides, but you know, possibly modifying and changing practices for getting medical attention, as well as some treatment recommendations. These are all important and these are all new. This is uncharted waters for all of us. But we also recognize that patients and families also need support, and that support comes in many, many, many different ways. And one thing that we're definitely clear on is that living in this pandemic for many people, whether you're affected by sickle cell disease or not, creates a real sense of economic instability, particularly for those whose employment cannot very easily be done from a work from home strategy. So we know that there can be significant effects on the economic stability of the family in our individuals affected by sickle cell disease. Next slide, please. So we also recognize that because of this pandemic and because people who normally are so giving of themselves and are consistent blood donors or willing to go and donate blood at a drive have not been as willing to do so. Understandably, people are instructed to stay home. People are nervous about leaving their homes and donating blood is not at the top of people's minds. So a lot of blood donor drives have been canceled, and there's widespread concern that we are either currently living in or soon will be facing significant blood shortages. And the reason this is important is because a significant percentage of individuals, both kids and adults who live with sickle cell disease, are on regular blood transfusions or occasionally need a blood transfusion. And so blood shortages are of paramount concern to all of us in the sickle cell community. Next slide, please. So what are SCDAA's actions? What are we doing about this? So first and foremost, we've been working to enhance education and awareness around COVID-19 among the community, and I'll talk a bit about that. We are also fundraising for our local communities because we understand that there are increasing needs for our community-based organizations and the individuals that they represent. As well as our third action is a blood donation call to action in trying to be part of the solution to the impending or current blood shortages. Next slide, please. So for education and awareness, I'm really excited. You know, Dr. Sue and I are the co-chairs of the Medical and Research Advisory Committee, which we call MARAC. It is a standing committee and it consists of 33 members who have been selected and have been standing committee members. And they represent experts in sickle cell disease from around the globe. Although a majority of the individuals, as you can see listed here, are based in the United States, we have experts on MARAC from the United Kingdom, from Italy, from Lebanon, from Ghana, and from Tanzania. So we really have a global representation on this committee with global and very important perspectives, not only on sickle cell disease, but importantly on the COVID-19 pandemic. So the MARAC is charged with advising the organization, that being the SCDAA, on all topics related to medical and research issues in sickle cell disease. And so naturally, this standing committee was called to action to advise on the pandemic. Next slide, please. So the MARAC recommendations are as follows. So MARAC was called to meet on this issue in March. And it was very clear from that initial meeting that we needed to develop educational material for those living with sickle cell disease and their caregivers and family members. And that that education should include guidance on self-management, like self-disease management, as well as practical advice on how to successfully navigate living in the COVID-19 pandemic. And this included topics such as how to access care in the safest way possible, how to be prepared in your home and in your workplace, and what to do about your ongoing medications, and for those people on transfusions, what to do about ongoing transfusions, and what to do if you're on a clinical trial or considering getting on a clinical trial. And so we went really into really quick action and developed the patient and caregiver advisory. And this is advice, and it is also it also lists a bunch of frequently asked questions. The details of this advisory will be given to you by Dr. Sue in the second part of this webinar today. So, and it was important for us to also make sure that the patient and caregiver advisory had fast and widespread dissemination, and that it was easily accessible to all the people that needed to see it. Now, that was the patient and caregiver advisory. And I will tell you, in this initial call with MARAC, it was quickly decided that if we were going to develop recommendations for patients and caregivers, especially since they were going to change usual practice and the usual ways that individuals with sickle cell disease access care, that we needed to develop a companion advisory for healthcare providers that mirrored the recommendations that we were giving to patients and families. We did not want there to be a conflict. We did not want to be telling our patients and their loved ones one thing if we weren't recommending the same course of action to healthcare providers. And I was really proud of MARAC that, you know, in that very first call that that realization was made. And I think it's been critically important to the successful implementation of these guidelines. Next slide, please. So this is the first page of the patient and caregiver advisory, and the highlights are listed there, but Dr. Sue is going to go over the details in subsequent slides. But this is the first page. It's regularly updated. You'll see that the one I have here says March 28th, which I think was our first advisory, and we are now at the April 10th advisory. So we've updated this at least three or four times as new information comes about and as we get feedback from the patient community about what they need for us to address. Next slide, please. So in terms of the companion provider advisories, you can see it looks very similar, but the content is different and it's geared more towards a healthcare provider audience. It is also updated regularly, with the last update being on April 10th as well. And I'll spend a little bit of time here. So the highlights are that we are encouraging healthcare providers to do everything to assist their patients with sickle cell disease to be able to stay home and to stay well as much as possible. And so we've asked that wherever possible, if it's not absolutely imperative that a face-to-face encounter occur, which is usual standard medical practice, to try to institute telemedicine wherever it's safe and possible. And that would limit the amount of times that individuals with sickle cell disease need to leave their home in order to get medical care. We've also asked that healthcare providers call in prescriptions or submit them electronically to pharmacies, and preferentially submit those prescriptions to pharmacies that will deliver to our patients' communities, so patients don't have to leave their homes to go pick up prescriptions. We've also given recommendations on how to advise patients to manage acute pain at home whenever it seems safe to do so. And that if this is done, that very close contact with the medical provider must be instituted. And again, to consider prescribing opioids electronically for patients. We also wanted to highlight that it's really important to have providers encourage their patients to stay on their existing chronic disease medications, and where appropriate to consider starting new treatments if it's appropriate for the individual patient, especially if it can help minimize some of the need for acute medical care. We've given recommendations on how to best triage patients over the phone or in person for COVID-19 infection, and to remind them about what I told you earlier in the talk about acute chest syndrome and how it can look very similar to COVID-19 infection and how the two can occur at the same time. We've given some suggestions on how to approach patients on transfusions if we do actually encounter blood shortages, either now or in the future. It depends on which community you're living in. And we also advised that new enrollment on clinical trials be halted, but we gave room for certain exceptions, of course, if it's in the best interest of the patient based on their relationship with their healthcare provider, then of course they should be on a clinical trial. But in general, if it can be delayed until we get past this pandemic and it doesn't compromise the patient, then we've suggested halting new enrollment. And that's primarily because being on a clinical trial usually means that you have to come in frequently for visits. And that would mean having to leave your home more often than usual. And then we've also encouraged healthcare providers to help assist with blood donation and to remind their patients that their family members who don't have sickle cell disease, to try to encourage them, if they're otherwise young and healthy, to go and donate blood, and to remind our patients that their family members who have sickle cell trait are eligible to donate blood as well, because sometimes that's a misconception that if you have sickle cell trait, you can't donate blood, and that's simply not true. Next slide, please. So what are the next steps for the MARAC advisories? Well, first, we have already actually modified both of our advisories for global audiences, as you'll see in the picture at the top left. That's the front page of the advisories that have been adapted by Dr. Ahuini Frimpong, as well as Dr. Makani, for a sub-Saharan Africa audience. We've already had translations into Arabic, as you can see on the top right there. And we are in the process of getting these advisories translated into French and Spanish. We have had requests from all over the globe to get these advisories into local languages. And in fact, there is a subcommittee of MARAC right now, which is translating the advisories into several different languages that are commonly spoken in the Indian subcontinent. We've also developed some tools that you'll see there, the colorful pictures there, to help individuals address their emotional well-being in the context of this pandemic, because we realize that living through this pandemic is not just a challenge to us physically, but it's a challenge emotionally, even for individuals who don't have an underlying chronic medical condition. And that part of our responsibility as providers of healthcare is to help individuals, have the best mental health and emotional well-being through this process. So there's a subcommittee of MARAC led by three psychologists who have longstanding expertise in sickle cell disease to help develop these tools. And right now they're working with another subgroup of MARAC of pediatric hematologists with expertise in sickle cell disease to increase the number of tools we have available for children living with sickle cell disease. Next slide, please. So what about disseminating? So, the main point of dissemination is through the SCDAA website, and that's sicklecelldisease.org. So that's where all of the emotional well-being tools, as well as the updated advisories, live. And there are links to lots of different social media platforms, as well as some existing platforms, such as the One SCD Voice and the other platforms that you see here. We also have this available for our 46 member organizations and their websites to link to, as well as there are some notable professional and federal partners that we've either disseminated the guidelines to, or for example, in the case of the American Society of Hematology, ASH, or the American College of Emergency Physicians, or ASEP, they have direct linkages to our website and to these advisories. So just to make it clear, that includes hematologists broadly, as well as emergency medicine or ER doctors very broadly, which is good. And we've given lots of webinars to various communities, including the Sickle Cell Foundation of Georgia has hosted us two different times. The Sickle Cell Consortium has hosted us on a Facebook Live event. And we've also given updates to providers. Next slide, please. Now, just segueing into sort of the second area of focus for the SCDAA is to develop monetary support for local communities. And SCDAA, as many of you know, launched the COVID-19 Emergency Fund campaign not that long ago. I think it was the end of March. And you know, very interestingly, there was a mission to raise $100,000 in 10 days. And I don't know how Beverly and the staff and everybody did it, but that was accomplished in far fewer than 10 days. And some early donors include Global Blood Therapeutics, which donated $100,000. It was fantastic. As well as the top ladies of distinction and their members all over the country, as well as our event. And I'm sure Beverly can give us an update on that. But as of last week, we had already raised over $120,000. And this will be funding available for mini grants for our member organizations to help our families and individuals affected by sickle cell disease in their local communities. So this is a fantastic effort. And I think more to come. This, and if you're inclined to donate, go to www.sicklecelldisease.org. And I know it's cliche, but no dollar amount is too small. Next slide, please. So our third arm, as your was call to action to try to help increase the blood supply across the nation. And we've always played a role here. Because we realize how important blood transfusions are to so many of our individuals affected by sickle cell disease. And so several steps have been taken, including urging member organizations and individuals to contact their congresspersons about the urgent need for organized and safe blood donations during this pandemic. There's also a letter, as you'll see, the front page copy of on the right side of the slide there, that was co-written and co-signed by the American Society of Hematology as well as the SCDAA, addressing our concerns to some of the largest national blood centers across the US. And so it was definitely, you know, a way to make sure that they understood that not only were we concerned and that we wanted to make sure that they appreciated our concern and the needs of our patients, and that our patients needed to be prioritized just as much as individuals with any other disease. But that we also wanted to work together to be a part of the solution and to use our network and our base to encourage donations amongst our community, particularly amongst those communities of color, which are usually very underrepresented in the blood donation pool, but for which we could help. And we know that for individuals with sickle cell disease, they're much more likely to find compatible blood if it comes from a donation made by a person of color. And so not only were we addressing our concerns, but we were trying to be a part of the solution. So we've also directly facilitated communication between some of our member organizations and blood donation regional offices to make sure that they're collaborating to increase at the local level some blood drive participation. Next slide, please. So the SCDAA, MARAC, and Patient Caregiver Advisory, again, here, listing what you and your family need to know. Next slide, please. So I'm going to just do a few slides here, and then Dr. Sue's going to take over. But first and foremost, how do you know if you have COVID-19? Well, first of all, you can't know unless you get tested. You can assume you have it. There are a lot of people out there who assume they had it and got over it, but no one will know for sure unless you get a test. What are the symptoms? Most people who have COVID-19 have fever or cough or shortness of breath or a combination of two or three. But you know, in talking to our medical and research advisory colleagues from Italy, which you probably all know is one of the earliest countries hit by the pandemic, they told us that some people have presented with diarrhea or a change in taste or smell. So it's important to know that not everybody who has this infection first has symptoms of fever and shortness of breath. Sometimes they have other symptoms that are listed here. And if you have any of these symptoms, it's important that you call your healthcare provider right away to discuss what you should do next. The test consists of putting essentially a Q-tip up your nose and to the back. It's not comfortable, but it's short-lived. And that's the way people generally get tested. So it doesn't require a blood test. It doesn't require a blood urine sample, but it requires a specialized test, and not every place has the test. So if you're having symptoms, you need to contact your medical provider. And if they think you need to get tested, they'll figure out the safest way for you to get the testing done. Next slide, please. So it's really, really important that if you have symptoms, yes, call your medical provider. But if you are having severe symptoms, which include having a lot of difficulty breathing, some very unusual and severe pain or pressure in your chest, if your family thinks that you're showing confusion or can't wake you up easily, or if you have darkening of the lips or face, which can be an indication that your oxygen level is low, those are reasons to get seen emergently. Oftentimes that would mean calling 911. But you know, waiting around to you know, have a chat with your healthcare provider in this setting is not a good idea. And we just want to make sure we're clear that although it's best if you call your health provider beforehand if you're having more mild symptoms, if you're showing anything severe, you need to get help right away. And now I would like to let Dr. Sue take over. First thing I want to do, though, is I want to recognize some SCDAA board members who have been integral participants and members of MARAC, and that includes Dr. Wanda Witten-Sherney, Dr. Kim Smith-Whitley, Dr. Janice Nelson, and Dr. Gwen Pohl. So your SCDAA board has been very, very active in advising the development of all of these advisories, and I thank them.
Great.
You're up, Dr. Sue.
Thanks very much. So I'm in Chicago, where it actually is snowing a little bit today. But just to reinforce what you just said, that if somebody's having difficulty breathing or starting to lose oxygen, that is the time you really do have to call 911, really have to come in. Next slide, please. So we're going to go through some of these. I'm not going to read every word, but the idea is to give some highlights and also direct you to go look at these advisory statements yourselves. So what can I do to prevent the spread of COVID-19? Staying home is the main message. Trying to stay at least 6 feet away from people is felt to be how far these droplets can spread before they fall down to the ground. Washing your hands with soap and water, 20 seconds, that means you sing the happy birthday song. Twice probably, or you can use hand sanitizer with alcohol. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, mouth, and face, which is something that I'm always doing on the phone whenever I'm on TV, but trying to avoid doing that. And then, you know, doing some other common sense kinds of things. People have also started to greet each other from a distance with no hugs or handshakes. It makes people a little bit sad, but you could do like air their readings and stuff. Next slide, please. Now, what about masks? So masks, there's two or three different messages to know about masks. One is that they are not really enough to protect you from getting infected, but a lot of times it's for you to wear this mask to protect others. So if I'm, you know, breathing a little heavy because I'm climbing stairs or something like that, or I have to clear my throat, then I might be spewing something out. And so having a mask helps protect other people from me. And there's times when somebody could have a COVID infection already, but not any symptoms, and that's the time they could actually still spread stuff. So having that mask helps to reduce it. It doesn't mean that you got the mask, you can do anything you want. It's trying to just cut down on risks. They can be reused. There's all kinds of new directions about how to do the reusing, novel things that include baking them, sterilizing them in different kind of ways. You do not want to spray Lysol into your mask and then reuse it, because Lysol that's still on the mask can be really bad for your lungs. Don't do that. Next. How can I get myself and my family prepared? Well, so this is more for somebody who has a chronic condition like sickle cell. It would be to make sure you got all your medicines refilled. I've been spending several hours each day talking to patients and trying to get their medicines refilled. If they don't have an asthma medicine, I say, well, you really should have called your asthma doctor for that, but I'll do it anyway, just to make sure you're still okay. And trying to have some contact, if possible, with pharmacies who will offer home delivery. There may not be that many of them, but if they do, that is a golden opportunity. Making sure you have a thermometer to take your temperature. You heard about fever. Well, if you don't have a thermometer, it's going to be hard to know whether you got a fever. You have mother's hand who is calibrated to know if you got a fever or not, but it's hard for anybody else to be able to tell. And then if you have a prescribed medicines for the sickle cell, like hydroxyurea, glutamine, penicillin, folic acid, voxelotor, crizanlizumab, deferrasterox, and many others, these were prescribed for you to keep you in good shape. And so to stop those medicines now, when you need to be at your best to fight off COVID infection, would be not the most wise course of action. So try to keep your prescribed medicines around. Next. How to get prepared? Well, having enough household items and groceries, which does not necessarily mean that you have to have a 50-foot tall stack of toilet paper. Staying in touch with other people. There's all kinds of electronic methods. Some people will actually call out their balcony to talk to people. We don't do that much in Chicago because it's too cold. But you've seen also pictures of people in Italy singing to each other across the alley or across down the street. Keeping children occupied with homeschool activities, arts and crafts, trying to think about who's going to watch your children or your pets or your other loved ones if you get too sick. And then finding out if working from home is an option. There are some people who really have to go into work, and then some things where you may not have to go all the time. Next. So here's some outline of things to do if you do have a fever. If I do have a fever, I don't just go straight to the emergency department. Using that thermometer to find out if it really is a fever, if I'm just flushed for some reason. Calling your doctor is a key thing. Sometimes the emergency rooms could be really crowded, and figuring out which place to go or what way to go about things. There may be some other avenue. So calling and trying to keep in touch with somebody is a key idea. Next. But that was also for if you're not having shortness of breath and losing oxygen. Those kinds of conditions, you do want to call 911 or go to the emergency room right away. But just having the fever, you may not have to do that. And then should I continue getting my chronic transfusions? We already heard about the possibility of blood bank shortages. Right now, we don't think COVID is 19 virus, coronavirus is transmitted through blood. So we believe that the blood transfusions are still okay to do. And the reason that you were put on blood transfusions in the first place still exists. If it's to prevent stroke, if it's to prevent more acute chest, if it's to prevent some other kind of problem. You should talk to your doctor about whether there's any risks of missing a transfusion or if there is an alternative. For some times, there might be a little bit of flexibility. Instead of you have to come in on Thursday at 3 o'clock, you might be able to do something else due to the difficulties. And then if there is a shortage of blood supply, do ask your provider if there are alternatives. But the bottom line is to talk to your doctor. Next, please. So once again, going to the emergency department sometimes could set you up for crowding, frustration, and things like that, as well as you're going to an emergency department where the other people are worried that they might have COVID-19 as well. So you're probably gonna expose to a lot of people if you do. So think about it, call first, try to figure out if that is the one thing you have to do, but try to use other options. Next. So this is a homemade slide for me. Because I work in healthcare, there's days that I'm going to clinic, going to see patients, and I worry about bringing things home to my family. So I put when I come off work, I'm changing my clothes, putting them in a bag to change into another set of clothes, come back home, leaving the shoes at the door, spraying them with something, separate out the laundry, do the separate batch of laundry. We talked about how soap and water is good for killing these viruses, and shower again with soap and water and shampoo and stuff like that. Not enough hair to do much. Thank you. Next. And then if I don't have sickle cell disease and I want to help the people who do, what can you do? Donating blood. Donating blood, getting other people to donate, spreading the word. This is something that even when you're on a lockdown type of situation, it's considered an essential service to be able to have blood donations, and you should be able to be allowed to do that. And they give you cookies and juice at the end. Next. Talking to children about COVID-19. So I'm in pediatrics and it is tough. You have a very challenging situation. Society structure is upended right now. And, you know, having your own kids at home for 3 weeks, 4 weeks at a time with no end in sight is a challenge. Homeschooling only goes so far. But there are suggestions and tips. Some of it is to try to keep structure so that you don't have a kid getting up at noontime, running around in pajamas for 2 weeks at a time with never washing or anything, having some tasks, having some conversations. And these are things where there's tips coming from all different sorts of directions, from church groups, from CDC, etc. But I'm going to mention too that the CDC does have a very, very nice website for that, and that's shown here. Next. So talking to children, one is to be calm and reassuring yourself so you don't freak them out just because you're anxious. Making some time to talk. Considering reducing screen time that's focused on COVID-19, because for children as well as probably for adults, too much information can lead to anxiety. I think I need at least some time away from hearing the steady stream of news and statistics and statements about COVID from time to time. Providing information is honest and accurate and appropriate for the age of the child. And reminding people that some things about COVID-19 that you see on the internet or social media may not be completely accurate. Sometimes there's rumors on the internet. Sometimes it's not completely true. And then having moments to teach children every day actions to reduce the spread of germs, you know, coughing into your elbow, washing your hands. You might as well tell them to brush their teeth too. They have plenty of time to do this now. Next, please. And so some of the examples that in this very nice CDC website they give is some almost like a script of how you can describe things to a child. What is COVID-19? It is a new virus. Doctors and scientists are still learning about it. Doctors, experts, and schools are working hard to help people stay healthy. You know, fairly simple, but it's factual. And then what happens if you get sick? Well, from what doctors have seen so far, most children actually don't seem to get very sick. While a lot of adults get sick, most adults do get better. And then if you, the child, do get sick, it doesn't mean that you have COVID-19. Not every infection is gonna be COVID-19. People can get sick from all kinds of different things. And if you do get sick, the adults will help you in any way that you need. Give the kids some security and some something to lean on. Next, please. Now, how do I stay informed? Well, some of these things we're, you know, telling you again. Sicklecelldisease.org is where we're posting this information. OneSCDvoice.com is another place that we are putting basically the same kind of stuff. I like the CDC's website. You can get lots of information from lots of different places, but I want to have reliable stuff that isn't going to swing back and forth like crazy with no firm basis. So I tend to rely on this. Next, please. Well, that's the end. Okay, so we're hoping that people put questions into chat. And let's see. So far, I see. What does the COVID test consist of? Dr. Biree, do you want to answer that one?
Yeah, I do. And I think Beverly was, if she's still on, was going to also manage the questions.
Okay.
But yeah, so the test is not a blood test. It's not a urine test. It's uncomfortable. There's basically a long Q-tip up your nose. I'm not going to lie. But, you know, it's short-lived and it gets a lot of good information. So I wouldn't be afraid of it. It is going to be uncomfortable. But the bigger question, I think, is getting access to testing, and depending on where you live, that has been a challenge. I live in Connecticut, and I mean, we've been on the front lines of this for a number of weeks now, and we went from having almost no capacity to test to fairly decent capacity to test whoever we want and whoever we suspect. And my guess is that that will become increasingly the norm across the country in the coming weeks. So that's how the test is performed. Beverly, are you there? May have lost her. I wonder if I took her profile accidentally in order to get in.
Oh, I think you might have, yeah.
Oh boy, okay.
The next thing in the chat.
We'll go through them.
Yeah. The next thing in the chat I see is, can SCDAA put together a social media kit for donating blood to make it easier for us to forward to our community and our website? Fabulous idea. Mm-hmm. It will probably lift something from AABB or some other blood bank type of place.
Yeah, we can definitely do that. That's a really good suggestion. The yeah. easier we can make it for you, the easier it is for you to spread the word. So I think that's a great idea. We'll do that.
Hi, this is Arielle. While we work on getting Beverly connected, I did just want to let you know, she did say that we SCDAA will be working with the Red Cross on that mission.
Great.
Red Cross, very good.
Perfect.
And I do have a few more questions that came to me. If you wouldn't mind, I can pose them to you.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
We had several people wondering if the slides will be available.
Yes, we're happy to share the slides. They'll be on our website. You know, at minimum, that they'll be. We'll be happy to do that.
We had a question, and I'll just read it out verbatim. I understand that only about 20% of people test positive. This happens even though only the most severely ill people are tested. Is it possible that the test is not accurate? This would be a huge concern.
Yes and yes. So I'll take that one. Yes, it's true that only a small percentage of people who get tested are actually positive. And that's because lots of other things, like Dr. Sue said, can give you a fever and a cough. So it's not surprising that even with people presenting with, you know, symptoms that can seem like COVID-19, there are a lot of other viruses and bacteria out there that present very similarly. Including the common cold that we really can't even test for. So I'm not surprised. I don't think any of us are surprised at the numbers that are positive. The other thing is, I think, the question of how good is the test. There are reports that the test is, you know, not always able to pick up the infection if the infection is there. And the tests are being refined. And but there are reports of people having to be tested more than once before eventually the result becoming positive. So so the answer is yes to both portions of that question.
Great, thank you. We have two additional questions. First question, let's see. Do we know of any morbidities for sickle cell patients? If so, how did they present?
Dr. Sue, you want to take that or you want me to take that?
Let me try that. So we've been, we've had the interesting experience of being on a lot of phone calls with people in different parts of the country, different parts of the world, who have seen, who are in sickle cell centers and are looking for what COVID does in people with sickle cell disease. And again, this is a new virus, new disease, so we weren't really sure how things are going to go. And there was the expectation that, like influenza or maybe some other kinds of conditions, things may go a lot worse for somebody with sickle cell disease. I think so far there's been 46 cases reported in this website, covidsicklecell.org. And the picture of it seems kind of like, it's not spectacularly bad. It's kind of like COVID for other people is about the way it's hitting people with sickle cell disease, but there is probably a little bit extra chances for acute chest syndrome problems, and especially if somebody is a little bit older with more organ problems. So if somebody, somebody is looking at the overall picture for COVID-19, it's like the more problems you come into the infection with in your heart, your lungs, your kidneys, your whatever, then the harder you have a time of fighting it off. So I think we're seeing a similar picture. Is that probably?
Yeah, I think that's a fair description. I think that even though we have the registry, that not every case of someone with sickle cell disease with COVID-19 is necessarily in the registry. It's only a fraction. And so even though it lists the outcomes for those 46 patients, we don't really know what the universe of patients is. We don't know how many really well and for whom their healthcare provider never put them in the registry. So it's a nice snapshot, but I wouldn't take it as definitive yet. But I think the important thing to get across is that from what we tell, Dr. Sumai, like he said, spent a lot of time talking to experts all over the world. From what we can tell, most sickle cell disease that have gotten COVID-19 recover. And a small percentage of people to the disease have been cases of deaths of individuals with sickle cell who've been infected with COVID-19. And you know, it's not always predictive who's going to do well and who's going to do poorly. But as Dr. Sue said, it seems that people who are older and have other underlying medical conditions in addition to their sickle cell disease do worse, and that is very similar to the whole population. You know, that's the message that we're getting in all our media sources, that if you're older and you have other medical problems, that you're at greater risk for severe infection. So the best thing again is to try not to get infected in the first place and to maintain a very good state of health.
Yeah. So if you have medicines that are prescribed for you, take those medicines.
Thank you very much. We do have a few more questions. Is that all right? Or would you like us to hold those and save those for?
No,
might I think we'll keep going.
Great. Well, Dr. Cherney, who's on this call, would like us to mention that patients make their providers aware that the consensus for providers document exists. Would you like to say anything else about that?
That's really important. And that's why we're trying to disseminate this as widely as possible. But we realize that not every healthcare provider is going to see this. So Dr. Cherney is absolutely right. That's why we have the provider advisory available on the website. So you as a person living with sickle cell disease or a caregiver of somebody with sickle cell disease, you can go right onto our website and see exactly what the provider advisory says. You can read it and you can give it to your healthcare provider to help them help you. The other thing is that in one of our most recent updates, we are becoming more and more aware that people in our community are finding it challenging to work from home or to get appropriate accommodations at work. and that a lot of people simply can't stop working. We need the income. And so we were very careful in our most recent update to advise that patients seek from their employer some alternative ways to work, either from a distance or to make sure that they implement physical distancing measures at the workplace, making sure that if you do have to come into work, that you are at least away from everybody else, and other guidelines that we link you to, and then the CDC through our advisory. So our goal in putting that information into the advisories is, again, it's a way for you to be able to use that as a tool with your employer. You can print it out and give it to the employer and say, hey, this is what the Medical and Research Advisory Committee, 33 people from around the globe who are expert in sickle cell disease, are telling me. And if it's not just your employer you need to give that to, you can hand it to your human resources representative, or you can hand it to your healthcare provider and say, look, I really need your help in terms of getting a letter written for work to make my employer and my HR department understand that I'm very high risk for a really serious infection with COVID-19, and that we need to figure out something for me to be able to continue to make an income, but do it in a safe way. So Dr. Sherney is absolutely right. Take the recommendations, read them, and give them to whoever you think can help you live in this pandemic in a very successful and safe way.
Thank you. Another question we received, let's see, is COVID-19 testing a priority in all states for sickle cell disease?
Unfortunately, no.
All right. We also received a question, is hydroxyurea helping? Is it helping to ward off COVID-19?
Well, we don't know the answer to that, but we have no reason to suspect that being on it is going to make things any worse. In fact, as the Medical and Research Advisory Committee, we took that issue head on because another disease organization, not sickle cell disease, but another related blood disease, in their recommendations suggested that being on hydroxyurea was a bad idea. But we took that issue head on. There is absolutely no reason to think that being on hydroxyurea poses any increased risk in the setting of COVID-19. In fact, it may help prevent pain episodes. It may improve your hemoglobin level. There are a lot of good things about it. We've known everything about this drug for decades. So yeah, Absolutely important to stay on it if you're on it.
And reduces the chances of acute chest syndrome, reduces the sky-high inflammation kinds of problems. So there's everything to say that hydroxyurea ought to help. I don't think we can say we have proof of that, but it should. If it's prescribed for you already, you really should stay on it, yeah.
Thank you. We have a question that goes back to the discussion about cloth masks. The question is, how does a filter help with cloth masks?
This is so cloth masks are for the general public to try to avoid you spreading your droplets out to other people. If you have a filter that's really going to try to take out stuff from the air around you, try to protect yourself, that would have to be a really tight filter, and it would probably become harder to breathe for a while. So I think really if you just go for the idea that a couple layers of cloth, this is cloth that's like I think like t-shirt cotton or those kinds of thicknesses of cloth, a couple layers of those is felt to be the right amount that you can stop the droplets coming out of your mouth and nose, but still be able to breathe. One of our colleagues said that he was trying to run for exercise in the countryside or in his neighborhood while wearing a mask. And it's hard to run because you can't breathe through this mask. So if you have too much filtration going on with that mask, it's gonna be a hindrance to you, going to cause you more problems.
Great, thank you. We have a question. Are we aware of any difficulty getting to the ER for a crisis during the COVID-19 pandemic? Has it been difficult getting care?
We've not heard that. And, we have one of our MARAC members, Dr. Katerina Minitti, is in New York City. And she probably, out of all of us, has seen the most cases of COVID-19 in sickle cell patients. I'm pretty sure that's probably the case right now, since she's right there in the hot zone of COVID-19. And I've not heard any reports from her about having any difficulty getting to the EDs. We've not been aware of that at the SCDAA. We've not heard those affected by sickle cell disease saying they're in trouble. Could be very long waits in the emergency department. There's no doubt about that, because so many people are going there now because of, concerns about having the infection. And in many cases, that's the easiest and best way to actually get tested. So people are going there in droves. But I'm not hearing that there is any issue with the emergency medical response systems or delays because of the pandemic. I don't know, Dr. Sue, are you hearing anything like that in Chicago?
It's mostly a matter of the crowding and of the emergency medical whole system being kind of close to capacity, yeah.
Great, thank you very much. We received a question. Do you expect that the antibody test will predict immunity? If it does, it would be great for caregivers to know whether or not they can pass this disease on to people they advocate for.
Yep. That would be good.
Really good question. I don't think we have the answer yet.
Yeah. So there's other viruses where we do have antibody tests as the main way to figure out if somebody is protected or not. So after I got hepatitis vaccines, then I have an antibody test that shows now I have antibody against this hepatitis and I'm not going to be able to get hepatitis. So now I can work among people who might have hepatitis or antibodies against the virus that causes mononucleosis. That's our standard way of testing about that. And so the hope would be that you get some kind of panel of antibody tests that are kind of like those things. And then you have some information about whether you have never encountered this virus, you've encountered it and you're ill right now, or you have passed that and you've developed immunity to it.
Yeah.
So that's the hope for these things.
Yeah, and I think the question of whether the immunity is long-lived or short-lived, that those are questions that we don't have the answer to, but we are on top of that. We are paying attention to that, and that's why we have the regular updates to the advisories. But that's a really important question, and I think not quite been figured out yet.
I see. Do you recommend that caregivers or parents who work in high-risk areas take a leave of absence or not work during this pandemic?
Yeah, we've gotten that question a lot. And I think the message is every case is different. It really has to be examined on a case-by-case basis. But we understand that in many circumstances, the primary caregiver of the person in the home with sickle cell disease is somebody who works in a high-risk setting, like a healthcare setting. And oftentimes this is a parent caring for a child with sickle cell disease. And that is why we were very, very deliberate in our last advisory update to make note of the importance for workplace accommodations and physical distancing, and keeping in mind that what we wrote in the guidelines could serve as the basis for a case for implementing whatever measures are possible. Everybody's employer is different. Everybody's benefit system is different. A lot of the sickle cell programs have social workers that you could tap about these questions to help guide you. Your 46th member organization of the SCDA around the country are poised and ready to address questions. So please, the sicklesdisease.org website, you'll be able to see which of the 46 member organizations are closest to you and would probably have the most relevant information in your community about additional resources to help with these matters. But this is a concern that we have as well. And there's not a sort of one size fits all answer.
Thank you. We received a question. Is a 2-week quarantine enough for families? Is it okay to visit family after 2 weeks?
Well, my understanding of the recommendations is that a 14-day quarantine after a known exposure is a reasonable amount of time, that if you're going to manifest symptoms, you're going to do it within that time frame. And so that's where that quarantine 14-day sort of recommendation has come from. But in terms of visiting family, this comes up a lot too. So if you can be absolutely sure that your family in the town next door or the nearby state, wherever it is, has been self-quarantining the entire family for 14 days and you've been doing the same, you know, one might make a case that visiting would be okay. I mean, it's really hard to say. You never know what other people are really doing. You don't know who came into the home. You don't know what happened. So if that's the question, I think we do have to get creative. You know, it's difficult to quarantine. Some of us have been doing it for a month already. Mm-hmm. Very, very difficult. Dr. Sue, do you have any different interpretation of that question or answer for it?
Yeah, it's still be pretty prudent and doing a lot of keeping distance, not touching excessively, things like that. But it's hard.
It's really hard. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you. We have one additional question that I will pose to you, and then we will begin our wrap up. And I'll read the question out. Two of my family members reported getting a blood test and results were provided in 20 minutes. They are healthcare providers. The site is in Brooklyn, New York. Are you aware of the test also being provided as a blood test?
This is a point of care test, I think. And so at my place, I think they started doing it 48 hours ago. We haven't seen that much results yet, and it's considered still something to figure out exactly how useful it is going to be. Have you heard something different, Dr. Andemariam?
Yeah, I think I agree. I think it's basically hospital to hospital, not necessarily even city to city. Every hospital is probably using a different testing kit. But I am aware also of what we call the point of care, sort of the rapid test, which could be very useful. I mean, you want to get your answer right away. And I think for the cases that we're seeing here in Connecticut, and we're seeing a lot of them, that has not been the experience so far. You know, people were waiting a week initially, now they're just waiting a couple of days. So it's getting better and better and better. So for those of you in the country who've not yet really been as affected by the community spread of COVID-19, we hope by the time it gets to your community, a lot of this will have been worked out and faster turnaround time for results, easier ways to get tested will occur. The question about doing the test through a blood draw, I'm not familiar with that having to be done. Dr. Sue, are you familiar with blood draw testing for COVID infection?
I think that's what it is, yeah.
I mean, here we're doing it through the nasal swabs with the Q-tip. So.
Okay.
Well, thank you both, and thank you for answering these questions and for your time this evening. I'd like to turn it over to Beverly. Beverly, are you there?
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yes, okay. I wanted to thank Dr. Sue, Dr. Andemariam for their tireless efforts. The members of MARAC have been meeting every single week, and they meet over the weekend, really trying to get all of the advisories updated quickly and available for patients, caregivers, and providers. So please join me virtually in thanking them for this very important information tonight. Many of the people who were texting me throughout this session indicated that it was very informative. And we hope that as this pandemic continues, we can come back and provide some updated information to all of you. I also wanted to echo that we will have the slides available on our website. in the next couple of days. I'll work with our communications team to make sure that that happens. And if you have additional questions for Dr. Andemariam or Dr. Sue, please feel free to reach out to them or to me at the office, and we'll get that information to them so we can get the answers back to you. We are also very interested in hearing directly from patients and caregivers of any issues or any concerns that you're facing in your community so that we can get that information to the MARAC committee for discussion, and information can be updated in the advisory as needed. Dr. Andemariam, Dr. Sue, anything else you'd like to say before we close?
Yeah, can I do one more? This is news from basically today. There's a new idea that people might be able to get helped by treatment with the serum from people who have already gotten over COVID and have now become immune. And so this is becoming a clinical trial. That is, I just heard about it this morning. And people, if somebody has had COVID and gotten over it, they could be a valuable source of a treatment for those who are currently sick. So if you know of such people, spread the word that there is a clinical trial that's looking for donors of serum. So not their red cells, but the other parts of the blood could have the antibodies that might help another person.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. That's very cutting edge, and I think that's where we're headed in a lot of treatment protocols. The only other things I can think of, Beverly, is to encourage those of you out there to go onto the One SCD Voice platform. Dr. Sue and I are pretty consistently checking out the platform. There is a chat room. There's I think it's called the Social Smart Wall. What other people affected by sickle cell disease are saying, because people post what they're thinking, what they're feeling, and it's a good way to I think connect with others who are in a similar situation. And Dr. Sue and I try to chime in on, you know, questions that are more medical or research oriented, and we have patients for those living with sickle cell disease who also moderate, which is really fantastic. And then the only other thing I want to say, nobody asked this question this time, so maybe our myth busting attempts are working, but lately we've been getting asked if having sickle cell trait protects you from getting COVID-19. And the answer, as far as we know, is no. We wish that were the case, but in case that was a question that someone forgot to ask, because we know it's out there, it's traveling in the myth circles. If you have sickle cell trait, as far as we know, you stand the same risk as everybody else, but you can go and donate blood, and you should. That's it.
Great. Thank you both for this very informative webinar, and thank you participants, board members, and staff for your participation tonight. Have a good evening. Thank you again.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Be safe. Bye.